barren desert, but you shall not die of thirst. You shall wander far in safety, though you do not know the way. You shall speak your words in foreign lands, and all will understand. You shall see the face of God and live. Be not afraid. I go before you always. Come, follow me, and I will give you rest.
Good morning, friends. We are not crossing barren deserts this morning. I presume most of us aren't, but we are in a sort of wilderness. In the biblical sense, we are in a type of exile. Not the kind of exile the Bible talks about where we have been banished from our homes and sent off to a foreign land, but because of the pandemic in which we have been living for 3 months now, we are in a kind of exile in the way the Bible talks of it spiritually. The grand narrative of the Bible talks to the most urgent needs that we have as human beings. What is your most urgent need as we have gathered here? The Bible talks about our needs to be grounded and connected, to be protected and to belong, to know who you are and where you fit in. The Bible contains the stories of the people of God when they lost all of that. People torn away from their land, torn up as a people, torn down by loss. Do you feel torn some days? I do. Some of it is about being torn as a pastor, to not be able to see people freely, to visit with them in the hospital or over coffee at Natalie's, and certainly to worship with them and sing with them, to pray hand in hand, and to work side by side. And some of my feeling torn is personal fatigue, thinking as I leave the house each time, is it okay to be going where I'm going? Do I have my mask? Am I making good and safe choices? So the biblical story I think about most these days is exile. It's a heart-rending and poignant part of the Old Testament in our Bible. Exile is a forced departure from that which we hold dear. And it's not just giving up things we like to do, but it's being cut off from our life source. In fact, in the Old Testament, to be in exile was to be physically removed from God. Well, we know that as followers of Jesus, we are not physically removed from God. In Matthew 28:20, Jesus says, "I am with you always until the end of the age." But physical distancing is now part of our vocabulary. And I've been very carefully in these most recent weeks to talk about physical distancing and not social distancing, because social distancing is something that we can't afford to do. You can also see how weary we are of physical distancing. As the county and our states move from one phase to another in reopening, as Rock County did this week in moving to phase two with different guidelines of reopening businesses and public buildings and even churches, public gatherings, we can see that people are eager to resume normal life. As people of faith, often we are torn about what choices we should make, including the question that people are asking most frequently, when are we going to get back to church? So what phase are we in as a church? Teddy Ray is a Methodist pastor in Lexington, Kentucky, and he recounts the things that most of us know, but of which we need to be reminded, which is that we have heard that churches pose a particular risk to disease spread, and it seems like a cruel irony, doesn't it? One story this week said churches and taverns are two of the greatest risks. I'm not sure what God makes of that. But we bring a large crowd of people together, people who love each other and haven't seen each other in months, people who like to sing or at least hear other people sing and didn't realize how much they've missed it, people who have all sorts of different individual and personal standards and awareness about things like physical distance and touch and masks and kids running around. So as a church, when we think about bringing all these things back together, we worry about becoming the next epicenter of infection. And yet we ask with the psalmist, how long, O Lord? How long until we make this decision and these decisions ongoing? And especially as we listen to health officials talk about how this will happen in cycles and waves and not a continual easing of the disease. It can be overwhelming. I know it is for you. And I know it can be for me. I worshiped in Boise, Idaho at the First United Methodist Church when I was living there years ago. And Dwayne Anders is now their pastor. And it's a very large church. They call it the Cathedral of the Rockies. And he wrote an opinion piece for their local newspaper this week. And he said that leaders of faith communities will tell you that we have never closed as the church. Our buildings may have closed, but our ministries have continued, and that is certainly true here at the Milton United Methodist Church. Like their church, we have shifted studies and worship to online. We have continued our missions of feeding people. But in his words, and I agree with this, he says, I believe that God cares more about the how than the when of returning to worship. God cares more about how we return to being in person than the when we will return to in-person worship. Our holy scriptures teach us in Romans 12:10, honor one another above yourselves. When we open is about options and the calendar. How we open is about loving our neighbors. So it's a reasonable question for us to ask, why is it that some faith communities have opened, some will soon open, and some will wait? Dwayne Anders says, think of a stoplight, green, yellow, and red. During COVID-19, we've learned that there are medical professionals and state officials and denominations in each of those categories, green, yellow, and red. Some faith communities are green. Green is a go. They're ready to go. They have opened. They have listened to state and denominational leaders, read the health guidelines, and they have prayerfully made the decision to open now. They will work to provide safe in-person worship. And people whose light is green themselves will show up. Some faith communities are yellow. Yellow is caution. Yellow slows down. These faith communities are listening to state and denominational leaders. They've read the health community guidelines, and they have preferably begun ways to open in due time. And they will open up slowly, step by step. And many in their community are glad that they are moving slowly and will wait to participate. Some faith communities are red. Red is full stop. These faith communities are listening to state and denominational leaders. They're reading the health community guidelines, and they are prayerfully beginning to work on a plan to open in time. They may wait until there's a vaccine or a cure. They may wait until worship can look just like it did before COVID-19. Many people are in the personal red zone. They have personal health issues that put them in a category of higher risk, and they won't return until we have much greater testing or a vaccine or a cure. And every faith community has people at each level, green, yellow, and red. Our goal is not to convince you to move to the next level. Our goal as people of faith is to honor each other. As we learn where others are, we honor them. We know that there are churches in and around Milton that have reopened for worship. We know that there are others who have said they will be online only for the foreseeable future. At the Milton United Methodist Church, we have a team of leaders who are meeting regularly. We are calling them our Back to the Future team because we believe that being faithful is more about going forward than it is about going back to something that existed before. We're also consulting our healthcare and mental health and public health professionals in our congregation. We know that Jesus was holistic. His ministry showed us that our spiritual and physical, mental and emotional and economic health were all interrelated, and where one suffers, the others tend to as well. And we are also acknowledging, honestly and openly, that we are going to experience a pastoral transition on July 1st as we welcome Pastor Jonathan Kim as the next pastor of Milton UMC and as I depart for Cargill United Methodist in Janesville. We at Milton don't want to be making any decisions now that preempt our congregation and leaders from working with Pastor Jonathan and answering these questions and making this discernment when he arrives. I believe that at Milton UMC, we are in the yellow zone, given the number of health precautions that we still need to address. We aren't in green mode. We are being cautious, but we are working and praying and discerning. We will continue to worship online, and Pastor Jonathan will bring new ways of doing so as he brings his pastoral gifts to this ministry. We will continue to do our ministries of outreach as long as we can do so, while also caring for the health of our staff and our volunteers and our community. We will continue to monitor our financial health because we believe that God is calling us to be active in mission and ministry, not in spite of the pandemic, but because of it. And for those of you who financially support this congregation during this challenging time, we are most grateful. As people of faith, another way of asking the question, when can we come back to church, is when will we come out of exile? You know, when the Bible talks about the exile, and it depicts it in 2 Kings and 2 Chronicles, which interestingly calls exile the Sabbath of the land, calling to mind how other parts of our world might be healing at this time when we are consuming less and using less and traveling about less. And the opening chapters of Ezra talks about the end of the exile. And then there is the prophet Jeremiah, specifically chapters 39 to 43, which saw the exile as a lost opportunity. What opportunities have you found in these past 3 months? And what opportunities might we continue to see together going forward? I can't predict the future, and I'm not an epidemiologist or a health professional. What if we are living with an awareness of COVID-19 for a matter of months, as many experts predict? What opportunities lie ahead in who we are and where we are as the church and as people of faith? What opportunity do you have in your current situation today? Maybe an opportunity that you didn't see existed 4 months ago when we were going through life busily and hurriedly and maybe taking some things for granted. Our opportunity is also our challenge. There are risks other than the virus. We can't dismiss economic hardship, emotional stress, those who are confined and living in unsafe and unhealthy situations. We know that challenge is not spread equally across the board. Those who are living in isolation, those who are responsible for young, not at all self-sufficient children, those who have been going months on end without contact or human interaction or a hug, single parenting, carrying deep anxieties about money, living in a home that's physically or emotionally unsafe. See, our challenge, as well as our opportunity, is that the church is the primary community and social support for a lot of people on that list. And it is more of a challenge when our buildings remain closed. There's a barrier to much of that social support. And so we know that staying closed does not come without risk to some of our people. There is challenge and opportunity, as the Bible said, in this time. Where for you is the challenge? Where is the opportunity for you in this exile in which we find ourselves? How do we acknowledge the pain and frustration around us without becoming despondent and overwhelmed and numb? Have not the recent weeks just become overwhelming? It's hard to care sometimes. How do we handle not one virus, but two, the pandemic and the tearing of our society's fabric by our long-standing crisis of racism? I don't know what it means that these have both broken open at the same time. Opportunity and challenge. You know, in the Bible, even though God's people were displaced from their land, their homes, and their temple, God was still present with them. They didn't believe it. But the prophet Ezekiel, in the first verse of the first chapter of his book, says, "While I was among the exiles by the Kibar River, the heavens were opened, and I saw visions of God." Have you seen visions of God in these extraordinary times? The exile is a tragedy in the Bible, but it's matched by a hopeful story as the return of God's people is described in Ezra and Nehemiah and in the last three books of the Old Testament. Because the message in the Bible, the reason it is such a pivotal story, is that the message of the exile is the story of restoration. What does restoration look like for you, your family, your loved ones, your faith community, your church, our online community? We have discovered a new community online of being church, and friends, that's not going to go away. Being together to worship physically will not replace the opportunities that we have to connect like this. We will go forward into a both-and world, not an either-or. I share with you this poem that was written by a 23-year-old poet by the name of Leslie Dwight. It's written in response to the fact that people have been talking that 2020 is a lost cause this year. And here's what she writes. What if 2020 isn't canceled? What if 2020 is the year that we have been waiting for? A year so uncomfortable, so painful, so scary, so raw, that it finally forces us to grow. A year that screams so loud, finally awakening us from our ignorant slumber. A year we finally accept the need for change, declare change, work for change, become the change. A year we finally band together instead of pushing each other further apart. 2020 isn't canceled, but rather the most important year of them all. Would you pray with me as this morning we lift aloud our breakthrough prayer? Dear God, we trust in you, Lord, to move mountains. We are willing, we are waiting for you to break through and amaze us with your love and your power. We ask you grant us strength, faith, and courage to fight the doubt and fear within us. Let our faith cast out fear. Let your love cast out evil. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Dear friends, thank you for praying for one another and the church. Thank you for helping one another with acts of kindness. Next week, we will receive in worship the gifts of the lay speaking ministry of the Milton United Methodist Church as they have collaborated to bring a worship service in farewell to yours truly as the pastor. And then I look forward to the final message that we will share together online on Sunday, the 28th of this month. Let us hear, O God. the timeless words, "Be not afraid," as we look in this time of exile toward our time of restoration.
You shall cross the barren desert, but you shall not die of thirst. You shall wander far in safety, though you do not know the way. You shall speak your words in foreign lands, and all will understand. You shall see the face of God and
dear friends, go now in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.